I think few questions which were no there in the chat box yesterday regarding the yes no table and why this no is appearing first, whereas in the dummy table it is yes who was there. So I hope it got solved by Dr. Shamshad. Why this why SPSS takes no as one and yes as later, because it's an alphabetical arrangement. So if you change the code like present or absent, then again absent will come first. So it takes, but again, when you present that in the table, it shouldn't be like you are starting with no, because we are interested in an outcome. So we are always interested in yes. So that's how in the dummy table you will find opposite. But that's the way SPSS takes it, right? So
I mean,
don't
a
get.
table, in a results table, is it always ideal to begin, like you said right now, the first row with like we usually say disease positive and exposure positive in the first column?
It should be like that because we are
Okay.
interested more in the outcome. That's what I said. Generally, if it is no, then but again, there is no such guideline. But if you read all that journals and papers and tables, the way they they present their results, so we have seen that usually they start with the present because it's a human tendency that we would like to see the first column and first row first, as comparison to the second row or second column. That's why. Otherwise, there's no such guideline. And if you are finding it a bit messy, that why we have to enter the figure there, then also it is not a problem. APA style table, you can enter no first and yes later. But it's good if you show the reader the no, I mean, present past work, because that's the outcome which we are interested in. So again, I'll go no through this session of comparison of mean and median. So that day we talked about the what are the underlying assumptions. So underlying assumptions which you are seeing now, that will be same for ANOVA and very much same for paired t-test also, because it's the comparison of mean or median, whether that mean is between the two group, or it is the paired observation of a single group, or it is a mean of more than two group, what we will see in the ANOVA, right? So if you have understood the assumption part of student t-test, almost similar assumptions will be there in the ANOVA. Exactly similar, because there's only one difference, that it is more than two group. And paired t-test also a very much similarity. So the first assumption was that the independent variable should be in continuous scale. So I hope this concept is clear to everyone, what is dependent variable and what is independent variable.
Yes,
So outcome variable which we are trying to predict or which we are trying to measure, that is the known as the dependent variable. So it should be in the continuous scale. Like we will see in the example there, like you have seen the gender distribution, the distribution of systolic blood pressure within male and female. So there the dependent variable is the systolic blood pressure. So the dependent variable should be always in the continuous scale. Independent variable should be a categorical one, that too with dichotomous category, means it should have only two category. If it has got more than two category, then we cannot apply the student t-test. We have to apply ANOVA. That we'll see in the third session, today's third session. So the independent variable should be of dichotomous in nature, and we have seen this, that there should be no significant outlier in the group of the independent variable in the terms of dependent variable. Means we will see in the command also that we see the distribution of the SBP across the two dichotomous variable, male and female. So that's the third assumption. I've told you regarding the concept of outlier. So you can see here that outlier, the data point beyond 1.5 box length from the edge of their box, are classified as outlier, which is shown by the dot, as you can see here in the case number 26. And the data points which are more than three box length away from the edge of the box, they are classified as the extreme outlier. So there should not be there should be few outliers, and it should not be many outliers in our data. And we have discussed also how to deal with the outlier. So you should always report the outlier in your data analysis that you have found these many outliers. If outliers are few, you can go ahead with the student sample t-test, because it is it is very omnibus test, and we can say that it is not affected by few outliers. So it is a robust test. So it can keep few outliers in your data set. But ma'am, if you wish to, yes
ma'am, if I wish to remove the outliers,
yes.
In that case, whether I have to delete it from the original database, or we can manipulate it on the SPSS itself?
You can do like the, because the outlier, they will behave differently with all the other, because if you remove the all the variables, all the reading of that case, then it might affect your, result. In that case, you can either, it's better that you delete all.
Okay.
But again, there are ways to tackle this problem. There are ways to tackle this problem. Generally, what we do, we replace the value of outlier by second highest or second lowest value, whichever is there in our data. Right? If outlier is towards the negative side, then you can replace it with the value of, you can see the range of the values and the second lowest or second highest. If the outlier is on the negative side, I mean lower side, you can replace it with the second lowest. If it is on the higher side, you can replace it with the second highest, not the highest value.
Okay.
So if you don't wish to lose one data, if the sample, like if there is a 3,000 or 4,000 sample size, even if you remove that, that is okay, not going to make any difference. But if the sample size is less, like 50 or 55, and there are four or five outliers, and you don't wish to lose the data, because this is outlier only for this particular SBP. It doesn't mean that it will be outlier for all other variables, because there are many variables of this case, right? Case number 6 or 26, it will have many variables. It will have CRP, SBP, DBP, LDH, SGOT, many variables. So it is not necessary that it will have all the variables will behave in outlier.
Similar manner, yeah.
Yes. So up to you, but whatever you wish to do, you have to write that. The only important part is you have to write that, because by doing so, it to the reader and to the reviewer, it appears that you did the analysis the way it has been recommended. That means you have at least checked for it. So they only want that you should check for it. And obviously, two or three or five outliers, if the sample size is more than 100 or it is fairly representative, you have calculated the sample size, then it is not going to make a difference in case of a paired t-test, ANOVA, and a student t-test. But again, if it is a small sample size, like many people do a case series study, like 20, 25, 30, then I don't wish to lose my even five data. In that case, I may replace it with the second highest of the, or I will proceed with the those five or four outliers, right?
Okay.
So, but you just report that by visual inspection, what you have to write. Maybe we have not, we have given this in the your PowerPoint also. You have to write that normality test and inspection of power, this box plot. It has shown that there were few outliers. You can name the number also, three outlier or five outlier. But the analysis was done keeping that five outliers in the data. Or you can write that it was replaced by an appropriate value, second thing. Or third, you can write that you have removed those outliers and then rerun the analysis. So depending on your wish, you have got three options. But usually what we do, we report the outlier and we proceed with the data, because we have seen many a times that it doesn't affect the result, the three or four outliers, right? But you will see today's example where you will apply the Mann-Whitney U test. There are many outliers. So you cannot If there are many outliers, then you cannot run this student t-test, because then it will not be in a normal distribution. So if there are many outliers,
so there is no any means boundary where it is few and where it is many.
It depends on the sample size, how much sample size you have taken. If it is 3, 4 out of 30, 40, 50, it is few. If it is, you know, out of 100, or if you have taken 5, and then, you know, your 9 data becomes your extreme value. So then it is, you know, you can say that it is a outlier. And then you can see the visual visual inspection of QQ plot also. QQ plot.
Yeah.
If it is not deviating, if it is showing the normalcy, that means that outlier is not affecting. In QQ plot also, you will see that there will be a few points which will be lying very far off from that point. You will show here.
Yeah,
only.
Yeah. So it is also more kind of subjective observation, I felt, in QQ plot. Because if there is a deviation, where to feel that this is normal, or where to feel that, yes, this is actually...
It is. Yes, you are very right. As opposite to Shapiro-Wilk.
Yeah.
Shapiro-Wilk is very objective, because you have... Because why this is so? Because see, when the sample size is more, then it is normally there is no deviation. I mean, usually it follows normal distribution. When the sample size is less, that's why the subjectivity is not allowed in less than 50 sample size.
Yes.
Did you get that?
Yeah.
In less than 50 sample size, we have to be very objective, because there are chances that the visual inspection of QQ plot, you may, because there's no guideline.
Yeah,
no,
exactly.
You just have to see that all the values should be across that line, which has been drawn.
Yeah.
But if the cases are more, then it usually, but you will see here that in QQ plot also, when it is more than 50, it becomes very obvious that it is not in a line. There will be many values which will be away from that line.
Okay.
And the more you do, like we do, we say it with the, you know, in our undergraduate days, when we were not able to hear some, you know, stethoscope se koi agar murmur, we were not able to hear. So what our teachers used to say, try to hear many normal sounds and then you will appreciate the abnormal one. So similar is with this data also. When you will experience a lot of data, you keep on doing the analysis, then that feel is there. Even with this QQ plot, that this is normal and this is abnormal. Maybe initial, we are very apprehensive whether, you know, it is normal or abnormal. So the more you do, the more you will have an idea that, you know, this is normal. And again, you have got many other tests also, like we have discussed about the mean and the standard deviation. That is also a little bit of objective only. If the mean value is less than 50%, if the SD value is less than 50% of the mean, then also we can say that it is following the normal distribution. So there are 3-4 ways. And if you are, you know, think from all the perspective, then obviously you can make out whether that data is normally distributed or not normally distributed. Okay.
Okay, thank you.
So there are basically, we have discussed this, that there are 3 reasons for this outlier. There's a data entry error. The person who have entered the data, like we have seen many a times here in the COVID, there were a lot of data sheets when there were a huge data entry error. So that can be there. The second, that's why it is, you know, recommended you keep on looking your data after every 3rd or 4th day just to check with these entry errors, because then you can remove these errors. Otherwise, an ID is important. If you have put a patient ID, and if you are doing, like we do many projects where we analyze the secondary data. In that case, if the patient case sheet you have entered, then you can recheck those data with that case sheet, whether the correct entry has been done or not. So that's important for to have a check on the data. See, because data is the most important part for the analysis. If the data is not, we always say in statistics that garbage in, and that's why garbage out. If the data is a garbage, then whatever analysis you do, it is not going to give you the output. So that's how all these methodology issues carries a huge role here. The, you know, instrument by which you are measuring, training of the investigator, repeated training, who is collecting the data, because that all the output depends on that data only. But we are, many times I have seen, we are very casual in collecting data and we are very sincere in analyzing. We want that the person who is doing the statistics part, he should be smart enough to yield something, to take out something, to make that value significant, to put good tables. But what a statistics or what a person who is doing the analysis can do, it is only, he will only yield the things which are there in the data. So that's how it is very important in the methodology where you are collecting the data. Everything should be very meticulously done. The person who is writing, the person who is entering the instrument, their validation, the tool check, especially all that Likert point scale. If you see the 5-point, 10-point pain scale, many a times, you know, you will not find anything. They, you student, if you're getting it done through the students or through some person who's not very sensitive enough, then what he'll do? He'll put 3-4, usko lagega kya ja raha hai mera? Strongly agree or disagree. Usme, he will, no, choose a midway, ki ye likh dete hai. So, unki repeated training ki bahut value hai. Unko aapko itna empower karna, I'm deviating from my lecture, but since you have raised this issue, so the data collection, if it is good, even if you don't apply models, it is a very famous term in statistics. Ki agar simple test se significant aa ja raha hai, iska matlab hai aapka data bahut acha hai. It is very good. If you have to put a lot of statistics, that means there is some problem with the data or sample size. So that's why it is important that before we put all those models, if it is coming significant, then there is a, you know, role of all these things. Else, it will be like something we are trying to do, but the data, quality of data is very important. So you should have a check on these data entry errors. Measurement errors, again, we have discussed about the instrument, their sensitivity, the person who is collecting the data. And there can be many a times that there will be a genuinely unusual values. So the genuinely unusual values are the true outliers in the population. But the other two are man-made. It's because of us. But we cannot diagnose by seeing the data that whether it is due to the data entry error, measurement error, or genuinely unusual value. Then the underlying assumptions. We have done 3 assumptions. The dependent variable should be a continuous one. The independent variable should be a categorical one, that to a dichotomous variable, only 2 categories. And the third is there should be very few outliers or no outliers. And the fourth assumption is the dependent variable should be approximately normally distributed for each group of independent variable. And fifth assumption was the homogeneity of variances. It should be same in the to group. What do I mean by saying this? Variance we have read in the first session also. It's the variability in the sample which we have drawn from the population. So same variance means the 2 samples which we have drawn, it is coming from the same population. That's why the variance is same. So if the variance is same, then we will show in the table that which table part we should use. And if the variance is not the same, then we should use some other part of the table. And there are objective ways to do that variance. And that objective way is the Levine test of homogeneity. So how do we do normality testing in SPSS? So in the chat box also, you people were discussing regarding the Shapiro-Wilk test and QQ plot. Normally, discussing these 2 options, there are few other options also for normality testing. But I don't want you people to get confused, because if you have got more options, confusion will be more. So let's restrict ourselves to only these 2 options, because these 2 options deal with a lot of majority of your data. And the other we have discussed, that is about the mean value. If the standard deviation is less than 50% of the mean, usually it follows the normal distribution. Shapiro-Wilk test is an objective test. Here the p-value is not desirable at all. We don't want the p-value to be less than 0.05. because null hypothesis says that it is the normal, normally distributed. So if the p-value is more than 0.05, that means that Shapiro-Wilk test is not significant. That means the data is not this normally distributed. The QQ plot is the other way. So if QQ plot is used when the sample size is more than 50. Okay. Regarding the homogeneity of variance testing in SPSS, variances should be equal in both the groups, and we use the Levine test for equality of variance for this testing. Now let's do it in the SPSS. So the first question was, compare the mean values of SBP, systolic blood pressure, diastolic blood pressure, and total protein with respect to myocardial infarction. One was first and two was recurrent. So we'll go to the data. This is the data sheet. So assumption, what is my assumption? I have to see the distribution, this systolic blood pressure, diastolic blood pressure, and total protein. So all these three are continuous variable, and I have to see it across the MI order. This is also a categorical variable with two categories, first order and recurrent MI. So what I'm going to do, I will go to analyze. So first I have two assumptions I made regarding the continuous data of nature of the dependent variable. An independent variable is a categorical one. The third one is there should be no outlier. It should follow the normal distribution across the group. So these two we will see with the explore option. So remember, analyze, descriptive, explore. If you open this, then there is a dependent variable. So the dependent variable is the systolic blood pressure, diastolic blood pressure, and total protein. So I'll move these three to here. And then independent variable is the MI order. So once this MI order you have entered, I'm only interested in plots now, normality plots. And so I'll go here, normality plots with tests. I will uncheck this stem and leaf because I don't require this here. And I'll press continue. So this is the only thing which we have to do, and then I pressed OK. So if you see the output, you can see here. Yes, so this is the test of normality, right? You can see the significant value. Normally, if the Shapiro, you can see it is more than 0.05 in the first and recurrent order, whereas it is less than 0.05 for diastolic blood pressure in the first category of MI, and for total protein it is less than 0.05 in the first category of MI. But again, since the sample size is more than 50, we are not going to comment on the tests of normality. So we'll go down, and if we'll go down, we can see here that it is usually majority of the values are lying over this line. So it is the normal QQ plot. Then if we see the normal QQ plot in the recurrent MI order, so there will be six graphs. If there are one variable, so we have to check it across the two categories. So the normal QQ plot of systolic blood pressure in recurrent order MI, this is again normal. You can see a little bit of deviation here. Can you see these points? So, but there are few in numbers. If you see detrended, we don't have to see. Now, if you see the box plot, can you see any outlier here? Any outlier can you see in this? You can say yes or no?
No outlier.
Yes, here there's no outlier. Okay, but then again, you come here. You see the normal QQ plot of diastolic blood pressure. So it is majority of the values are over this line. You can see there is one value which is lying a bit far. But again, visual, the majority value are on the line. Here also majority of the values are on line. So it is the normal QQ plot. And if you see the, here you can see. So can you see this, these here also in the box plot, you will see that there are two outliers, right? Or in the first, if you see the first graph, you must have seen this value. So we are not commenting this here, but if you see the box plot, you can see that there are two outliers. So what are these two outliers? I think we discussed before, in the last class also, that asterisk is an extreme outlier and this is a normal outlier. Right, to 23 and 173. Now coming to the protein, you can also see it is majority of the values are over this line. There is only one value which is lying here. And if you go down here also majority of the values, but there are two values which are not on the line. But again, it is a normal QQ plot because by two or three values, we cannot say that it is not following. And if you see this, then you can see. Can you see this box plot? So there are, can anyone comment on this box plot? Any one of you? You can unmute yourself and comment.
Ma'am, it is a box plot of total protein versus myocardial infarction order. In the first order, we have a outlier sample number 30. In the recurrent MI, we have three outliers. One is sample number 22, sample number 27, and sample number 158. All of them are greater than 1.5 box plot away, but less than 3 box plot away. So it is.
Okay, thank you, Viraval. So nicely explained by Viraval. And you can see that there are out of 193, it has got only 4 outliers. So we can go ahead with the analysis. Or if you wish, you can say that there were 4 outliers, but I have replaced this. So you can replace the values of this outlier by seeing the case number. So this was the explore option in the analyze, descriptive and explore, by which you test the normality. Now you have tested this, that this is a normal distribution. So now you will wish to put that compare means. So now you have to come to this compare means. There are compare means where there are 4 options. Means, one sample t-test, independent, paired and one way ANOVA. So what we have to click, this is the independent sample t-test. In the independent sample t-test, I have to, if the question, what does it say? That I have to check the SBP, DBP and total protein. So this will be the test variable. Grouping variables is the independent variable. But here you have to define the groups. And group, what you will use here, what you have coded in your code book. So your one is MI order one is the one code and recurrent is the two code. So you have to put this code and then in the options, you don't have to do anything. So by just clicking these two, you will press this OK. So can you see this? You can see group statistics, the mean values of mean and standard deviation of systolic and diastolic blood pressure and this total protein. So by this also you can see that data is normally distributed because mean is very less to the as compared to the 50% of the standard deviation is very less as compared to the 50% of the mean. Now this table is very horizontally extended. So I'll have to go like this to see the analysis and the output. So you can change the view of this table. Right click on this, there is a edit content. You have to click this on separate window. Come to this pivot option and click this transpose rows and column. And then you can close this. So now this will, that horizontal expansion, it will come to a vertical one. So it is easy for us to see and interpret. So I told you regarding the Levine test of equality of variance. It is also a test which value we don't want it to be significant. That's why p-value is not desirable here. And it should be more than 0.05. Then only we can say that the groups are having equal variance. So if you see the F statistics, the value is 0.342. That means, and the significance value is 0.559. 0.559, can you see it? The value? It is 0.559. So 0.559 means it is not significant. So every variable you can see here that it has got a equal value of equal variances assumed and equal variances not assumed. Although the difference is very minimal, but we have to report the first column where we have where the values are the equal variances assumed. Similar is the case with the diastolic blood pressure and total protein. Can you see this? So here we have to take the value of T because it's the T test, the degree of freedom. So what I'll do, we have to take the this column and then this column and then this column. Is it okay to everyone? We'll see in the dummy table how do we enter the data, right? So if we come to the dummy table or the tables, which, so I have to go here. So this was there. It is all the commands which are there in your PPT. These are all box plot, the QQ plot, and this we were here, right? So you have to enter, if you are doing it for the only one variable, then you have to enter the value of mean value, the standard deviation, the T value with the degree of freedom and the P value, right? This you have to enter and the interpretation will be it is significant. So you will write the values of systolic blood pressure across myocardial infarction was normally distributed as per by the visual inspection or by the reported in the QQ plot to test the normality, an independent sample t-test. Here we are missing on the outlier part. We have to put that also in the result that there were no outlier by the visual inspection of box plot. That line should be added here. We will add that also. An independent sample t-test was applied to test whether the mean systolic blood pressure. I think one of you can read this. Why am I reading this? Yes, any one of you, because in the usual lecture, we used to get it done by one of the participants. So we can do the similar thing here also. Yes, any person who would like to read this for me?
Values of SBP across MI order was normally distributed as reported in QQ plot to test the normality. An independent sample t-test was applied to test whether mean SBP of patients with first order MI was different from patients with recurrent episodes of MI. We observed a statistically significant difference in mean SBP of patients having first episode of MI, 147.5 plus or minus 31.5, versus patients having second episode of MI, which is 135.7 plus or minus 29.8, and PE is 0.016.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Lakshmi.
Thank you, ma'am.
Can you point out a mistake here which you would wish to correct it? There is one line here, independent sample t-test, where the SBP with the first order MI was different from patients with recurrent. Should we write different or should we write something else here?
I can't judge, ma'am.
Okay. Can you see the mean BP? Mean BP is higher where?
Yeah.
It is in the first episode or recurrent episode?
First episode.
That means the first episode, the SBP was higher with the person who were having the first episode. So you can write here that the mean SBP was higher in the people and even by in the first episode as compared to the recurrent one. And then you can, the rest of the values are okay because we are showing them the values also by how much it is high. I think approximately 12 millimeter. It is 135.5 in the recurrent episode, whereas in first episode, it is 147.5. Okay, so what is the interpretation? That mean SBP was high. So I don't agree. Maybe we did some mistake here. we should have written that the mean SBP was higher in the people who had their first episode of MI as compared to the recurrent.
First episode, yes.
Okay, then rest of the analysis, the rest of the description is fair. I'm fine. Okay, do you agree with this?
Yes.
Okay, so see the values first. If you are convinced and, you know, if you see the values, then these interpretation, because yesterday also I was going through the chat and participants were finding this interpretation part most difficult, right? That's what I came to know, that yeah, you people are having problem in interpretation. So interpretation, yes, actually everything is a process. If you know the command, that is a first step. Then second is the what to take from the command output. That is a second step. Then third step is the, once you put that value in the dummy table, then just observe that dummy table and you have your hypothesis with you and then explain it. Okay, it takes some time to imbibe though, these things, because everything is new to us, right? But with repeated doing, once you see the values, try to see the values. So even if I just hide this interpretation part, if you just see the mean value and recurrent, then it will click. Maybe that degree of freedom T value you will forget. But that obviously mean value, it will strike you that, okay, mean first is definitely much greater than the mean SBP of the recurrent value, right? If you have appreciated this much, then the other thing is a mechanical one, like the T value and the degree of freedom and the P value definitely. So just focus yourself on the mean value or whatever outcome you are taking, whether it is median, then you have to focus on the P value and the confidence interval. Obviously, the confidence interval, it is not important here, but wherever it is there, try to see the confidence interval also. Then with repeated, because you are doing it for the first time on your own, everything. So maybe, but by the end of the 4 or 5 days, when you will do it repeatedly, and then again, keep it doing whenever this workshop is over, then also, because it's a continuous thing. If you leave this now, then, you know, it's a very volatile. So you have to keep practicing so that, you know, you should will remember all these, especially the simple concepts. Maybe the later, the survival and hazard ratio, we don't do very often, that we, you know, even we forget. We have to do something. We have to again refer to the, you know, our books. So that's the way. We have also not learned in a day. It took a lot of time. And similarly, if you will keep doing it, you will learn it, because you have done great wonders. So it is not that much difficult part. So just is the consistency and little bit of that interface you have to be familiar with so that you can see it here. Otherwise, it is not that difficult. So now this is the second part. So anyone would like to explain this for me? Any other participant? This table, can you interpret this table? Anyone? Any person?
Yeah, ma'am. I will explain. As shown in the above table, we have done a comparison of mean SBP, TPP and total protein across the MI order. Here, the mean SBP and DBP differs significantly across first and recurrent MI group, while total protein does not.
Okay, yes. And why we have not given the individual value of all that SBP and recurrent here? Because many a times one of the participants wrote also that the reviewer says that don't write the values of table.
It happened to me twice, ma'am.
Yes, it happened to us also. I mean, it is there with everyone because all of us are learning. So initially we used to write, but later, no, international, in Indian journals, they don't have any problem. But when you send it to some international journals, they always come in. Then don't repeat whatever is there in the table. That's why you can see the description. We have kept it very simple. You know, we have not written any values. It's up to you. If you are sending it here, then you may add the values or you may write the values. Okay. But the most important is the that significant one. So the first two are significant, whereas the difference, and even if this, if you know, by simple table also you can make out the difference is very less, 6.8 and 6.7. So by difference of 0.1, it will not come significant, right? But Yesterday there was a discussion going on. If you take this sample, if you do this study on 3,000 sample, right, of maybe COVID, you have got 4,000 people. You have the data. And if you do this analysis, then this 0.1 protein will also come significant. Did you get what am I saying?
Yes, ma'am.
Means, if you increase the sample size to a greater extent, even the values, because 0.1 difference of protein is not a very clinical significance. Is it? Do you agree ki if there somebody has a 6.1 and somebody has a 6.5, then it is going to make a huge difference? No, it is not. Clinically, it has got very less significant, the difference of 0.1. But if we increase the sample size to a greater extent, then this 0.1, which has got no clinical significance, it will be a highly significant statistically. That's why there are two types of significance. One is a statistical significance, which you see here, and one is the clinical significance, which you feel while treating the patients or while, you know, doing the therapy. So clinical significance is also a very, you know, important role in interpretation. So that's why we say that excess of sample size is also not desirable. Because if you take too many samples, then also the clinically insignificant data will become highly statistical significant. Okay. So now, any questions up till this point?
डिग्री ऑफ फ्रीडम सब में एक जैसा है तो इट डज इट डिपेंड अपॉन द सैंपल साइज.
एक्चुअली इसमें अलग अलग होता है, जैसे इस पेयर्ड ये जो आपका सैंपल है ना, इसमें क्या होता है कि टोटल सैंपल माइनस टू करते हैं इंडिपेंडेंट सैंपल टीटीएस में, तो टोटल 193 है एंड देयर आर, सो द फॉर्मूला फॉर डिग्री ऑफ फ्रीडम इज 193 माइनस टू, सो इट विल बी 191 हियर. सो डिग्री ऑफ फ्रीडम ना वो आप व्हेन यू सी दैट टेबल ना, इट इज देयर, इफ यू सी हियर आई विल शो यू इन द फुल दिस थिंग, कैन यू सी. So the degree DF, the DF stands for degree of freedom. So it is there in the output always. So don't bother
about that. It is same kyun aa raha hai, like it is same
sample, because sample size is same for all the three.
Sample size,
degree of freedom depends on the largely on the sample size. So if the sample size is same, the degree of freedom sabka same aayega, right?
Okay,
so 193 hai. अगर किसी में मिसिंग वैल्यू होती तो हो सकता है अलग आ जाता. ओके
मैडम, इज देयर अ वे टू नॉर्मलाइज द पी वैल्यू बाय सैंपल साइज, बिकॉज़ इफ यू हैव अ लेस सैंपल साइज देयर विल नॉट बी एनी सिग्निफिकेंट, इफ यू हैव मोर सैंपल साइज देयर इज अ चांस ऑफ हैविंग सिग्निफिकेंट.
यस यस, सो देयर इज नो वे एक्चुअली, इट्स ओनली दैट वी डू अ पायलट इनिशियली एंड देन यू कैन रिपीट द सेम यू नो हाइपोथेसिस ऑन अ लार्जर सैंपल साइज. So that's where you can just check it, but by statistically you cannot make it significant or insignificant. Again, there are ways to convert your data, the not normal one into a normal one, by the Z score and by the log transformation. But generally we avoid doing that unless and until that is very much needed. Because if the data is not normally distributed, that means there is some problem with the sample size. Because if you take the sample size according to the statistical calculation, usually it follows a normal distribution. But again, if it is needed, then you may do the transformation, right? And by transformation, by transforming the existing data into a log one or into a Z score, then you can analyze. But there are problems with the interpretation in that analysis. Okay. So any other question up till this point?
What is the significance of T value?
T. Okay, T value is like chi-square value only. Means here you, because by seeing this T value, this P value comes. How this T value is like, there's a T table, you know, like there's a chi-square table, there's a big T table, when there are various values of T, and against that value of T, we take the value of P, right? There are two columns. One is a row and the other is a column. In the row you have the t value and in the column you have the p value. So depending on each value of p and you know significant, you take the significance value. That's the statistics and that's the test. We are applying t test here. So the t value is the, again we have taken it from the table. Okay.
So if you are giving t value, then I think there is no, I mean not much significance of giving the t value, if I am correct.
So can you repeat once again?
Yeah, so if we are giving the p values, like t value is significant for example, so t value kitna bhi aaye, I think it will not matter.
But usually we report the t-value, like we report the chi-square. Chi-square may be never say that, you know, you just write the p-value and you should not write the chi-square. Because p-value, if it is less than 0.05, see, ideally, in recent days, you have to now report the exact p-value. You don't have to write even the less than 0.01. Because then the person, the reviewer, he checks it by giving the t-value. Then he can check that whether you have applied this or not. Otherwise, randomly, any person can write that the p-value was 0.01 or 0.003 because he is not having your raw data. But these days, the reviewer, they ask for your raw data also. If you send it to a publication, to a good journals like PLOS and, you know, to the BMJ, they ask for your raw data and they check the analysis. So you have not even reported the t-value. It will give, I mean, it is not the way it should be done. You have to report the t-value. It is a wrong concept. You have, if you have understood like you don't need to report the t-value, no, it's not correct. You have to report the t-value. Okay. Any other query or question?
Ma'am, it's a more general question I have.
Yes,
suppose the analysis and the values have not come significant. Like we were testing some drug or something and the value has not come significant. Is it okay to publish that as well?
Yes.
Is it like acceptable? Or-
yes, yes. That's how there are many things. See, if things of non-significant, if it doesn't report, in COVID also, you must have learned that there were many treatments who were, you know, it's of values in the last round. This time we are rejecting that, the plasma therapy. Now the studies are coming that it is not going to improve the mortality. If the person, how it came, he has reported that it was not significant. If he wouldn't have reported that, like we would have kept giving the plasma therapy to each and every patient. Remdesivir, every drug, hydroxychloroquine, there was no difference in the improvement or mortality by giving the hydroxychloroquine. I'm not telling about the individual experiences, right? I'm just telling about the published literature. If we don't publish and don't report the things which are not significant, because as a medical person, it is our equal responsibility to remove or to stop a practice which is of no use to us. Right. So definitely you should. There is a publication bias. I know and I agree that if something is not said significant, there people generally they don't like to publish all the journals. But if your methodology is very sound, in that case, they look for your methodology and sample size and the other part of the study, which you have taken care of. If that is very strong and even if that is your values coming not significant, you should report it. And people are doing it. There is no harm at all. And if you take the courage, maybe, and if somebody publishes it, maybe there are many people who are sailing in the same boat, who are very much convinced with your data because they have also found the same thing. But they didn't have courage to report that. Right? So somehow either they manipulated or, you know, they did not publish.
Yes, ma'am. Actually, I had a study in which I did not get the significant results. So I wanted to assume because it got rejected from two publications. So that's why I wanted to ask once.
No problem. Maybe that's I said, there is a publication bias too. Because it's we have experienced this, but keep trying and that will be published in a lower ranking, lower impact fact journal. But at least it will be published so that it will be in the Google Scholar. And Google and the not even it is not a PubMed, doesn't matter. But you should publish it. Because the, see, after that, you know, you have you should read the these histories. You know, there were few people who always take the courage, and then many people start finding the same thing. That's how after meta-analysis we say, ki, okay, this is not significant, non-significant. That's why the role is not significant. That's the you know beauty of the individual research. If you publish your research, and there are 20 or 30 more people who are finding the same result, then maybe somebody will do the meta-analysis, will pool the result and say that it is not significant. That's the way you are seeing the, you know, advancement in the COVID therapy and maybe a lot of other therapies also. And I mean, treatment and SOP and guidelines, every year you are saying that change, seeing that somebody is getting dropped and somebody is being included, right? That is because the of this p-value and significance only.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you.
Ma'am, one question. Ma'am, we were discussing about, I hope I can ask right now or we can move ahead also yes, if yes, we are running short of time.
You are most welcome.
So for we representing... Don't
want to rush. If your no queries didn't get solved, then there's no point of telling you these things. So,
ma'am, for representing like t-value and chi-square value, during the course of this workshop only we have seen two kinds of things. One where the t value and chi square values have been represented inside the table where we have mentioned the other values, and one where we have seen the these values being mentioned below the table.
Footnote.
As yes. a footnote. Yes. And there may be certain places where the tables would be like there was for this one only. If we can see this table only, we are yes. seeing SBP, DPP and total protein across myocardial infarction order. So we may have many T values. Yes. So in the results part, we are going to discuss the value that we want to discuss about where we are writing the text and not mention the values. Whereas no. in the
Okay, please complete.
Whereas in the table where we are writing down the table or as a footnote, we may mention the exact values along with the p-value, as far as I understand.
Yes, it is entirely your choice. And many a times the journals, they give the guideline. But the table, you can put it either. We have put it down in the footnote, but you may have kept a separate column also.
For it.
Yes. And then you may have put... that those values there in the column.
And just discuss the part that we want to discuss that is coming as significant yes. in the yes. text and leave yes. the exact values.
Yes, you, that's the way it is.
And
done.
Just for p-value, ma'am, is it like p-value? I had this problem earlier with a paper of mine where I was mentioning the p-value separately in the table and just mentioning it as less than 0.05 or greater than 0.05 in the results text. So yes. what is the ideal way to do it? Write down the exact value everywhere or write down the exact value in the table and maybe matlab, what should be done in that case?
It's variable. It's variable, but generally all the standard textbook, it says that it should be reported the exact value.
Exact value in the result text as well as the table.
Yes, but okay. even if like if the value is very like sometimes it comes like 0.00001, you know, mm-hmm. very lengthy one. Then mm-hmm. in that case, you may in the like you did, that was a good one. Like you did in the text, you have put less than 0.05 and mm-hmm. in the table, you have given the exact value. That can also be done. There's no problem. There's no harm in that.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you.
Any other query? If not, then I will go to the median part, like if the data is not normally distributed. So if not, then I'll go. So now before I start with that, let's just have a few quick concepts on this non-parametric test. So just see this example. So anybody would like to read this slide for me, the research question? Any participant, Dr. Pankaj? I can see your name straight in front of my eyes. Dr. Pankaj Prabhakar, are you there? No, Dr. Soni?
Yes, ma'am.
Can you read this for me?
Yes, ma'am. Research questions. Objective, to study the effectiveness and integrated outpatient dual diagnosis treatment program for mentally ill patients and outcome will be number of inpatient treatment days. Among 25 subjects with schizophrenia, the mean number of treatment days was 7.2 with a standard deviation of 10.8 days. In another group of 20 subjects with bipolar disorder, the mean number of treatment days observed was 8.6 with a standard deviation of 12.4 days. Based on this, can we conclude that mean number of treatment days for schizophrenia population is less than the population with bipolar disorder?
Okay, so somebody else, let me see the participant's name, would comment on this. SD and mean. So I may ask Tanya. Yes, Tanya, can you comment on the mean number of days and standard deviation in both the group? Do you think by seeing the mean value, is it a normally distributed data or a not normal distributed data?
Variability is very
high. Ma'am, I am not clear on the concept. So
I said one concept. Somebody else?
May I?
The variability is very high.
So for schizophrenia, I think the mean is 7.2. And standard deviation is 10.8, so it's more than the mean. Similar to another group, bipolar disorder, the mean is 8.6 and standard deviation is 12.4. So again, the standard deviation
is more.
So it what seems that the data is not normally distributed.
So thank you, Rohit. But what should be the standard deviation so that by seeing it, you will come to know that it is normal? Just to make Tanya's concept a better one, I'm asking this question from you so that she will understand.
So if standard deviation is less than 50%, for example, 7.2, so if it is a 3.6 or less than 3.6, then the data would be normally distributed.
Okay. So Tanya, did you get the concept?
Yes, ma'am. Got it.
Okay. Thank you. So just by seeing the data, like Rohit explained, if it is not SD, and you will see the science with your data, and we calculate sample size also of the various students, there also you will see that especially that SD, this is very much higher than the mean because of the less sample size. You can see the number of subjects are 25 and 20. So if the sample size is less, then definitely the standard deviation is more as compared to mean. And even if you don't put the normalcy testing, we do the normalcy testing, but by seeing also, we can see that we cannot apply a parametric test. Now, there are two types of tests, a parametric test and a non-parametric test. So the parametric tests are the two t-test, pair t-test, ANOVA. And their non-parametric counterpart, we will see, is the Mann-Whitney-Wilcoxon-Sign-Rank test. Okay, there are two tests. We'll see that. Don't get frightened by these names, fancy names. You will remember this. And even if you don't remember, if you'll put the command, it is written like this, that it will automatically come to your mind. The second thing is, we read about the chi-square. So chi-square and McNamara, they both are the non-parametric tests by default. So there, that's why you must have seen that we did not check for normalcy and we did not check any normal distribution before putting a chi-square. Did we? No, we have not talked of those concepts. So generally, the chi-square is a non-parametric. That's why we can put it anywhere. I mean, in any data.
Ma'am, that's why I want to ask ki jab hum log kal analysis kar rahe the chi-square ka. तो एनालिसिस से फिर हम लोग गए थे डिस्क्रिप्टिव डाटा में, डिस्क्रिप्टिव से गए फिर हम लोग
क्रॉस
टैब में गए थे. एक तो वहां पर काई स्क्वायर आता है और नॉन पैरामेट्रिक में भी काई स्क्वायर आता है फिर नीचे जाके.
हां, क्योंकि काई स्क्वायर एक्चुअली नॉन पैरामेट्रिक है. आप वहां से भी कर सकते हैं. एक्चुअली एसपीएसएस में क्या है ना, एक काम को करने के लिए तीन चार कमांड है. ठीक है, लेकिन अभी हम लोग आपको सारे कमांड्स नहीं बता रहे. Why we don't want to tell you? Because then it will be very much confusing for you people. So now since you have learnt one chi square, na, if you keep on exploring, you will see that option many at many places. So you are right. Similarly, this also when you will see the pair Tites and Mann Whitney, there are 2-3 ways of doing that. But we are focusing only on one way, that is a simpler one. And once you have a command on this, then you may explore the other. Okay. Okay, Dr. Divendu.
Okay.
Thank you. So yes, you are right. And it's good that you saw those commands also. There, by this way, you will keep on exploring. So now if you come to the second... So violations, if there is a violation in the assumptions of normality data, then these parametric tests are not recommended, and we use either the transformation or non-parametric. So it's better to use a non-parametric, because transformation, analysis and interpretation becomes a bit difficult. So it's better to follow a non-parametric one. So this is the example of a non-parametric. It's a left skewed and a right skewed data, which you can see here. So if it is a non-parametric, then non-parametric analog of this student test is the Mann-Whitney U test, where we used to test the two medians. So Mann-Whitney U test is also known as the Wilcoxon rank sum test, but don't remember the other name. You remember it by the name of Mann-Whitney U. And this is assumptions again. It is only one assumption that the variable of interest should be continuous and it should be across the two categorical one. Okay. So now this is the question. Compare the median values of SGOT and LDH with respect to myocardial infarction. The same where we did the systolic blood pressure, diastolic blood pressure and total protein. And now we have to see the SGOT and LDH level with respect to the MI status. So again, we'll go to the data. Now you people can, one of you can tell me the commands. Yes, so who will take the lead? Tanya. Can you tell me the commands, Tanya?
Ma'am, I just joined the session, so I missed the first one.
Okay, you missed the first one. Okay, then see it carefully so that you will remember this. Yes, so who, any volunteer?
I'm Sony here.
Okay, Sony. Please tell me the commands. What should I do?
Analyze.
I have to check the assumptions now, because it's not normal distribution that I have to check. So what will I do? I'll go to
analyze.
Analyze then.
Descriptive. Compare medians.
Before compare medians, you have to see the QQ plot and the box plot. Because that should be done in every case. Okay.
Explore. Then the independent leads to SGO2 independent list.
Okay. And there's one more, LDH.
LDH.
In factor?
MI order.
Okay. Then what should I do?
Plots.
What should I do?
Uncheck the stem and leaf.
Uncheck the stem and leaf.
And
check the normality plots and tests.
Yes, very good. And then?
Continue.
Okay. And then okay. Now see the output. This is the, you can see here, it is significant, although we don't have to see because sample size is more than 50. Now you see the QQ plot. Can you see, Dr. Kamlesh?
Yes.
It is subjective, but you can make out that most of the values are not on the line. Right. So it is, this definitely is not a normal QQ plot. Yes. And the similar is with the this one. The other one, I think.
Box plot was also.
This one. This is also, the recurrent is also not a this thing, and you can see the box plot. There are so many outliers. See, so by this, then these outliers, you cannot remove this outlier, neither you can carry out the test. The similar is with the LDH. LDH, if you see here, but this recurrent, if you see, this is showing a bit of looks... a bit of normal. Yes, you are right. And then if you see this, again, you will see that there is only one outlier in recurrent. Can you see?
Yeah.
That's why recurrent was a bit normal.
Normal.
Here, there are many. So, even if there is one, the normal one group. So, what you have found out here, that across one, there was one normal. This you can say a bit normal. But the other was not normal, this one. So, it's better to carry out the parametric test.
Non-parametric.
Non-parametric. Yeah. Non-parametric. Very right. So what I'll do? And so these are.
I have one small question. If there are multiple parameters, and out of those parameters, if one or two is non-normally distributed, so should we go for non-parametric or both parametric and non-parametric kind of thing?
You can do both. You can do both. Actually, again, I said that if you see the standard books, many a times, because a problem with the non-parametric is basically the interpretation part. So even in COVID, we have seen that out of many parameter, in COVID cases, the patients have got many parameters. So maximum parameters were normally distributed, and if one or two parameters are not normally distributed, you can carry on the parametric test also.
Okay. So in that case, should we remove that particular parameter which is non-normally distributed?
Don't remove that. Carry out the normal distribution. Because I said that these T and ANOVA, they are stringent tests, and they don't get affected by this one, the outliers and the distribution. Because the data is large. These are more important when the data is small. And in that case, you have got a QQ plot, this Shapiro-Wilk value also. So it's better to carry out the parametric test. Non-parametric, we don't often do, but you should know how to do that in case, especially if there are case series like 15, 20, 25, then generally we do non-parametric. But if sample size is more like 100, 200, 300, then we do parametric. Especially in a case like you explained, that many variables are normally distributed and only one and two variable are not normally distributed. You can report. The most important thing is to report what you have found out. So you can commit, you can write in your this thing that two were not normally distributed, but you have done the pair t test or the student t test for that also. Because this is not affected by this deviations.
Okay.
So
Madam, what is the sample size is small and it is normally distributed.
Then you should definitely use non-parametric. Like 15, 20, especially in pathology and in where they are seeing the gross and tumor cells, and if they have to analyze something, the mean score or median, then we prefer to use non-parametric if sample size is less. So it's the analyze. So where were we? You have seen the, now what we have to do? Who were telling the command? Sony, you were telling me the commands.
Compare means? Then independent sample t-test.
Yes.
Then test in test variable, the SGO, I was LDH and test variable LDH.
So this you can do if you have planned that you will carry out the mean. This you can do.
I have a doubt, ma'am.
Yes, please.
Why we are not going in non-parametric test? Because it was not...
Yes, Viraval. I was that Sony would have answered. I was just waiting for her answer, actually. because she was telling me the command, so I was going, I'm not saying that this is the right way. Actually, I was waiting for her response only, because it is not a normally distributed one. So if I go by Dr. Kamlesh's desire, I mean, he said that if 10 variables are normally distributed and two are not, then he would have put this command to show that this is not normally distributed, but still he would like to compare the means, right? But normally what is there, that if the non-parametric we apply when it is not normally distributed. So in that case, what could have been done? Then you have to go to this analyze option. And then if you go to the non-parametric, can you see a non-parametric one?
Yes, ma'am.
So come to, there are same options like you see in the mean test. One sample, independent sample and related sample. So what option should I click here?
independent
sample. Okay, in independent sample, there is an option of fields also. So you can go like this, but it's better if you go through the legacy dialer. So in that option, you will see here that there is a legacy dialer. Can you see here? It's the old version and the new version. The new old version of the SPSS, it has got the basic one as the legacy dialer. Here you can see the two independent sample. If you click here, it is more simpler than that interface. Remember, so it's better use the legacy dialog. How will you will go? Analyze
non-parametric.
And legacy dialog. Legacy and come to two. It is, this interface is almost similar to your independent sample interface. Okay. And then I would have entered this SGOT, LDH. And in the grouping variable,
MI order,
same as, and again, you have to define 1, 2, continue. And you can see there are many options here. So it is a man between you, which I have to do. And then you have to, there are two options. There is a descriptive and there is a quartile. And then continue. And then, okay. Can you see here? So can you tell me the interpretation? So you can see the mean and SD, and here you can see the percentile also. So if you see the rank, but the problem is it discusses about the mean rank. Can you see the mean rank is 90.68 and 111 for SGOT, and mean rank is 91 and 102 for LDH. And if you see this value, the value of Wilcox, this Mann-Whitney. So this is 3149 for SGOT and 3403 for LDH. And it is significant, this one, SGOT. But LDH value is not significant. It is 0.182. And we have to report this Z value also. If you see the Z value, we have to report this Z value also. Z value and this from this table, we have to report this Mann-Whitney U, okay, value. So this mean rank, it is difficult to interpret the mean rank. So how to now take out the median? Because if you click the descriptive, it doesn't give you the median here. Here you will have descriptive in terms of mean standard deviation. But if you see the percentile here, you can see that the 50th percentile it is giving you. 50 and LDH is also giving you 830. Can you see? So this 50th is the median here. And this 830 is the median of LDH. But it is the overall median. It is not across the group. So if you report SGOT, the median level in the first and recurrent, that will not come from this table. Is it clear to you? So what you have to do, there is another option in SPSS where you have to go this independent sample, go to analyze, compare means. In the means here, if you want group wise median, then this is the SGOT, LDH, and here is the MI order. And if you see the options, you can remove this. And then there is the option of median. So if you press here and continue and see the output, so your median value will come here. Let me see, I think I forgot to press one command. So you can see here, the value of median value of SGOT in first and recurrent, it is 47 and 59, right? Overall is 50, which you are seeing here in the above table. Here, 50. Can you see the median?
Ma'am, can you repeat the steps once again for calculating the median?
Yes, median may repeat. I mean, this is a bit, there are two commands here.
Yeah.
The median comes from here also. Can you see everyone? All of you, please see it. It is a simple command, but at times it doesn't click that from where we should get the individual median across the group. We have to report the individual median because in independent sample t-test, we cannot report the overall median. So this is the overall median. For individual median, there is another option in SPSS where you have to go to analyze. In analyze, you have seen this option of compare means. So you go to analyze. Can you see where you have clicked for this independent sample? इसमें जो सबसे फर्स्ट वन है दैट इज कंपेयर मींस. कैन यू सी दिस? इफ यू क्लिक दिस, इट इज अगेन द सेम इंटरफेस. डिपेंडेंट में इट विल कम एसजीओटी एलडीएच एंड हियर इंडिपेंडेंट विल बी एमआई ऑर्डर, बट इट विल गिव यू द मीन और एनी. इफ यू सी द ऑप्शंस, दीज मेनी थिंग्स यू कैन कैलकुलेट, राइट? यू कैन कैलकुलेट ग्रुप मीडियन, स्टैंडर्ड एरर, मिनिमम रेंज, वेरियंस, ऑल दीज थिंग्स. We don't require all these variables. So right now we are interested in median. So you can shift, because initially this median was not here. I shifted from this panel to this panel. And then you click OK. So then again you click OK. So this will show the overall, with overall median, it will show you the individual median. I mean the group median, group SGOT, median of SGOT in the first order MI. Like we have reported for mean and median of SGOT in the second recurrent MI, and similarly the value of LDH. Is it okay for you people? Did you get it or should I repeat it once more?
Yes, ma'am, got it.
Tanya?
Got it, ma'am. Understood.
Okay. Anybody who would like this to be repeated? Dr. Divendu, Dr. Lakshmi?
Madam,
yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Significance of having this total median, matlab first episode ka bhi median or recurrent episode ka bhi median. So what is the significance of this total median?
It is just like, what is the significance of the mean value? Jo we have done na in the dummy table, I'll show you.
Exactly, main wahi keh raha hu ki
it's just the mean, median is replacing the mean. Like we have seen in the mean SBP level, we saw na interpretation where Dr. Lakshmi interpreted that the mean value of systolic blood pressure was higher in the first order MI as compared to the recurrent order. Nee, had it been, yes.
बहुत layman language में बात करूँ, तो ये जो total mean median निकला है, तो ये फर्स्ट ऑर्डर एम आई के सारे एस जी ओ टी को मिला के और recurrent episode के एम आई के एस जी ओ टी को मिला के निकला है?
अलग अलग, हाँ दोनों का, दोनों ग्रुप को अलग अलग निकला है. अगर इंडिविजुअल मीडियन की बात करें तो जो ये है,
और जो टोटल निकला है,
जो टोटल निकला है दैट इज पूरा एसजीओटी का जो पूरा कॉलम है 190 उसका निकला.
मैं वही जानना चाहता हूँ कि इस चीज की सिग्निफिकेंस क्या है, मतलब इसको निकाल के हम क्या करेंगे?
इसको निकाल के हम इंटरप्रेट करेंगे, इसको निकाल के, बिकॉज वी वॉन्ट अ मीडियन विच इज अक्रॉस द ग्रुप. लाइक वी प्रेजेंटेड द मीन in the table, how will you, there is no point giving the overall median because then you cannot interpret it.
Nahin, yeh question, asal mein Dr. Divendu ka yehi question hai ki overall median jo nikal raha hai, whether it has, whether it has got any significance or not, individual.
No. This table, see, this, yeh jo table hai, that is just to show you the mean and standard deviation, that this is not the normally distributed one. If you, even if you don't click this, like what you could, I could have been done, I could not have clicked this because that is creating confusion. So what you do, you go to non-parametric, you go to legacy dialer, don't click this.
नहीं मैम, हम उसकी, मैं उसकी बात नहीं कर रहा कि हमने क्या निकाला.
ओके,
ऐसे जनरल में पूछ रहा हूँ, जैसे कि एक ग्रुप का मीडियन, एक ग्रुप का मीन ये आया, दूसरे ग्रुप का मीन ए बी आया, उसको हम कंपेयर कर रहे हैं या फिर हम कुछ कर रहे हैं कि ये ज्यादा है या कम है, कुछ भी कर रहे हैं हम उसको.
हाँ?
तो ओवरऑल मीडियन का क्या सिग्निफिकेंस है, हम क्यों निकाल रहे
हैं मीडियन का क्या सिग्निफिकेंस? व्हाट इज मीडियन? नाउ मीडियन इज व्हेन यू हैव 10 पीपल. आई विल गिव यू एग्जांपल, लेट मी शो यू. नाउ आई हैव टू राइट ऑन द पावर पॉइंट. नो आई गॉट हिज क्वेश्चन. क्या सिग्निफिकेंस है, लेट मी चेक. सो देयर इज वन ग्रुप, मान लो दिस इज ग्रुप ए. ओके, इट हैज गॉट 5 पीपल एंड द एसबीपी ऑफ ऑल द 5 पीपल आई हैव रिपोर्टेड लाइक 140, 128, 136. I'm giving you the number only 5, so that you will understand in the larger perspective. Then 144 and 164. Okay, these are the 5 values. Now, how are we going to calculate the median of this? So, for calculating median, what I'll do, either I'll arrange in the ascending order and descending order. I will arrange all these values in ascending order. So it will be 128.
ये मतलब basically 140 आ गया.
50th position पे जो पर्सन है उसकी वैल्यू ये है, राइट? सिमिलर कॉन्सेप्ट इज देयर हियर इन द एलडीएच एनर्जीओ. So this, if it is, like if you make these value very extreme, like agar kisi ka systolic blood pressure 264 hai, okay, aur iska suppose 100, iska 96 hai, aisa ho sakta hai ek koi individual ho, jiska 96 ho, ho sakta hai, but in this case, will this 140 be affected?
Nahi
affect hoga. लेकिन अगर एक्सट्रीम वैल्यू में आप अगर मीन लोगे इसका, व्हेन देयर आर एक्सट्रीम वैल्यूज, देन मीन विल डेविएट एंड इट विल मिसइंटरप्रेट द थिंग, कि बिकॉज़ ऑफ अ फ्यू लार्जर नंबर यू विल मिसइंटरप्रेट दैट जो उस ओवरऑल ग्रुप का मीन क्या है. दैट्स व्हाई इफ देयर आर एक्सट्रीम वैल्यूज लाइक यू हैव सीन इन हियर द बॉक्स प्लॉट में, आपने देखा ना बहुत सारे वैल्यूज है विच आर ऑफ एक्सट्रीम इन नेचर. इट मे बी एक्सट्रीमली लो वैल्यू और इट मे बी एक्सट्रीमली हाई वैल्यू. इन दैट केस दिस विल बी अफेक्टेड द मीन. दैट्स व्हाई मीन इज नॉट अ मेजर विच वी शुड यूज इफ देर आर एक्सट्रीम वैल्यूज. सो सिमिलरली इन अ नॉन पैरामेट्रिक केस वी कैन सी दैट दीज वैल्यूज आर नॉट normally distributed. That's why it's preferably to report median. And median is the value of that variable at the position which is in the middle, 50th. Maybe if it is 100, then it is 50th. If it is 193, then you can, we write it n plus 1 by 2. So 193 plus 1 by 2.
वो एक सिंग ग्रुप में तो समझ में आ गया कि ये इसकी इसकी सिग्निफिकेंस होती है मीडियन की, लेकिन दो ग्रुप में अगर हम दोनों ग्रुप को कंबाइन कर रहे हैं तो क्या सिग्निफिकेंस रह जाएगी? मतलब वो तो वेरी हो सकता है।
दैट्स व्हाई आई एम सेइंग ना कि वो मुझे कमांड देना ही नहीं चाहिए था।
अच्छा,
दोनों ग्रुप के ओवरऑल मीडियन का इट इज मेकिंग नो सेंस, इवन मीन का कोई सेंस नहीं है। Even mean का कोई sense नहीं है। That's why I was saying na, I should not have given that command because you got confused only when you saw that command, right? अगर वो command मैं नहीं देती तो वो confusion आपको नहीं होती, तो वो command आपको नहीं देना है। It was my mistake, I shouldn't have picked that. So you go come to legacy dialogue, I'll again redo it for you. So it is the K independent sample. You just don't press this option. मैं मैंने status को कर दिया था, uncheck this. No need, because it is not going to give you any message. And the mean, right? You will just get the rank and the value of man Whitney Z and asymptomatic. And for calculating the median values along these two group, come to analyze. And then this mean, compare mean, you come here and then you press on options. You enter this median here, continue, and then I press OK. Then it will, that mean a median value of SGOT in the first MI order and median value of SGOT in the recurrent MI order, you will get it from this table, which has been entered. If you see the table, this is again the same commands and the results which we have seen in the SPSS. I will remove this. This was another way. So it was, yes. Can you see here? You want to study whether there is a difference in the SGOT level. So let's remove this IQR. Let me, don't report this interquartile range here, right? So you can see the median value and the Mann-Whitney U value. So the value of SGOT was not distributed normally across the MI, and it was a man by tested by QQ plot also. A Mann-Whitney U test was run to determine if there were differences in SGOT level between first and recurrent MI, and the distribution of SGOT level was similar as assessed by visual inspection. Median SGOT for the first order and recurrent order about this. You have to report the value of Mann-Whitney U, the Z value, and the P value. Okay?
P value to significant hai na ma'am, not statistically significant.
Oh, by mistake likh diya hai, mujhe lag raha hai. You are right. That is a mistake. From because there is another set of people who are writing this. So maybe it is by mistake they did it. So you are right, Viraval. Isne lagta na, wo jo tumhara LDH tha na, if you see this, the LDH was not significant.
Okay, thank you.
So by mistake lagta hai, uska p-value isme lik diya hai. Right, if you see here, LDH, can you see the p-value? It is 0.182. So maybe he has written by mistake, he has seen the value and by mistake that person has written. So thank you for pointing it out. We will correct this, right? So any other question? Should you want that any commands to be repeated? Otherwise, we'll go to the breakout room and we will practice these commands in the breakout room.
Ma'am, just once, ma'am, please.
Okay. So again, I'll go to the data sheet, independent sample t-test. Here I have to check so what I'll do, I'll check for normalcy. So I'll go to analyze, descriptive mein I'll go to the, sorry, analyze, then I have to go explore, because I have to reset this. This was the LDH and SGOT. So I have gone here, SGOT, LDH. Then click this plot, you go to plot, uncheck this stem and leaf, and check this normality plot. Continue with this, and press this OK, you will have output where you can see and you can visualize these plots. You can again see these normal QQ plot of both these SGOT and LDH. Don't see the detrended one. You can see the box plot of SGOT. And again, you can see the normal QQ plot of LDH across the first order, across the recurrent order. And then again, visual inspection of this box plot, you can see that there are outliers in the first order, but there is only one outlier in the recurrent. But you plan to go ahead with the non-parametric, come in the non-parametric, use legacy dialog, legacy dialog, legacy dialog. I'm repeating, use legacy dialog in the legacy dialog, because this interface is very much similar to the independent sample t-test for mean value, which you have done. So two independent sample, again, this interface is same. So you will SGOT and LDH in this variable list. In the grouping variable, it will be the MI order. You will define group. You have to enter those codes which you have given the value in your SPSS data label. So one was for the first order, two was for the recurrent. Then press continue. Here you can see there is a Mann-Whitney U test. There are four tests, but I will click this Mann-Whitney U because Mann-Whitney U is the non-parametric analog of the independent sample t-test. So I'll press OK. And then I will have the mean rank of SGOT and LDH here and the value of Mann-Whitney test and the for the SGOT and LDH, which you have to report. Value of Z, which is you can see here, and is this two-tailed significance or insignificant, where it is. Again, because the median value across the two group, it doesn't come through this command. So another command, that is the compare means. So you have to press this, then as move this SGOT and LDH to independent one, and MI order to the dependent. Press this option. Now you can see, I don't want this mean number of cases and standard deviation to be here because I only want median. I'll move this back to this place and I'll enter median here. Continue. Okay. And then you can see the median value of SGOT in the first order and in the recurrent order, LDH, the first order and the recurrent order. So that's the overall interpretation. Right, so what we do actually, we are giving you separate sheets and example here. But what we practical do, you check all the continuous variable first with for this normalcy. Even if you don't check across the group, this is okay. If all the continuous variable, they are normally distributed, you can go ahead with the parametric test, right? So straight away, we check for all. You put all, like what I'll do practically, I'll go to analyze and explore. And here in dependent list, I'll put all the continuous variable. And then I can check it for this normalcy, right? So is it okay for all of you? So now we have seen the comparison of two means across a dichotomous variable where the independent variable was a dichotomous one. Now we'll see the paired means or paired medians. How are we going to compare them? So for that, there are a few things which are important. So the paired test, paired t-test that is used when the participants are either on the same individual tested at two different time of point or the participants are tested on two different conditions on the same dependent variable. This is also known as the dependent t-test or repeated measure t-test, although most commonly we write it is a paired t-test. So now just see a few research questions and then see how this paired t-test can be used here. So there was a research question. Yes, one of the participants can read this for me. Now, who will read this for me? Dr. Divendu?
Whether there is a mean difference in dieters, daily calorie consumption before and after a 6-week hypnotherapy program. So we have to compare six before and after 6 week of a intervention.
Okay. Yes, right. Then in the second research question, if we come to the next research question. Doctor, let me call out the names of the participant. Otherwise, same name should not be there. Rohit, Dr. Rohit.
Yes. So second question is?
Yes.
Wish to test the effect of Prozac on the well-being of depressed individual using a standardized well-being scale that sums Likert type items to obtain a score that could range from 0 to 5.
Okay, so the study design would be like you initially take the score and then you give the Prozac and then again check it after the you have given Prozac, maybe some few weeks after that. So again, this is an example of paired value. When we are testing something before, we give the intervention and we are testing the same variable after that intervention. So this is a paired value and this is same as a first example. Now see another research question. Yes, who will read this? Let me. Dr. Salu.
Yes, ma'am. A group of people with a dry skin use a medicated lotion on one arm and a non-medicated lotion on their other arm. After a week, a doctor measures the redness on each arm. We want to know if the medicated lotion is better than the non-medicated lotion.
Okay. So this is a little bit different situation when, although it is also a paired value, the right arm and the left arm, this is acting as a paired value of a single, of two different interventions. That is the medicated lotion and non-medicated lotion. So this is again the paired value. They are being tested under two different conditions, right? Now, you please, one of you can read this question. So Veeraval, Sunita, Dr. Sunita can read this.
Measure weights of people in a program to quit smoking. For each person, we have the weight at the start and end of the program. We want to know if the mean weight change for people in the program is 0 or not.
Okay, so this is again pre-post. Like we saw in the first and second research question, we took the weight before intervention and after intervention, we again took the weight. So Dr. Shikha, can you read the other question?
An instructor gives a student an exam and the next day gives students a different exam on the same material. The instructor wants to know if the two exams are equally difficult. We calculate the different exam score for each student. We test them if the mean difference is 0 or not.
So this is again the same set of individual. They are going to different intervention, but the in all these research questions, what have you observed? That it is the same set of participants for the either the two intervention or pre or post interventions. So in such cases, we use the paired test. Is it clear up till this point while seeing these five type of research questions? So yes, in all these research questions, what have you observed? Either it is a pre-post value or under two different intervention, it's the same set of individuals who were tested on same dependent variable under two different conditions, right?
So ma'am, even the performance of the students test results, yes. First semester and second semester can also be done like the same thing. Paint test.
Yes. It can be done.
Thank you.
So now assumption is like one dependent variable measured on a continuous scale. The other independent variable, it has also got two categories, but it should be a related group or the matched pair. Like we have seen pre, post, or under two different situations. And it's like the same which we have seen in the independent sample t-test, that there should be no significant outlier in the difference of the two related group, and it should be normally distributed. So these are the only three assumptions here. So no outlier. So this is true for all the test mean value difference which we see, that the dependent should be the continuous, independent will be the categorical, and there should be no significant outlier, or it should be normally distributed. So there are four assumptions.
Madam, thoda sa main, sorry to interrupt. मैं इसी स्टेज पे आप ये डिफरेंस बता दीजिए कि हम मैकनीबर कर रहे थे फॉर सेम प्री पोस्ट काइंड ऑफ थिंग एंड वी आर डूइंग दिस पेयर टी टेस्ट. आई थिंक इफ यू क्लियर दिस स्टेज तो मैं ज्यादा
वेरी राइट. मैकनीबर प्रोपोर्शन, यस वेरी राइट. हियर वी आर टेस्टिंग द मीन, सो द आउटकम इज चेंज्ड हियर. लाइक in this case, exam case only, if you just calculate the percentage of students who have gotten more than 60% before and after, it would be McNamara. But if you take the outcome as mean marks scored by the student,
it
will be paired.
When it is proportion, it is McNamara. Okay.
Yes. When it is proportion, it is McNamara. That's why in McNamara also, I told you that it is very much similar to paired t-test, except that it is for the proportion. And that's why I show you the legacy dialogue of McNamara. Because the interface of legacy dialogue of all non-parametric, it is very much similar to the parametric. Otherwise, in the newer SPSS version, we have got more advanced feature. But I am not telling you the right now. Maybe when we will have an advanced course on SPSS, then I'll tell you all those advanced options. So that's why we are keeping basic SPSS statistics in this course. Okay. So this outcome variable here, it is a continuous one. That's a dependent variable. And their assumptions would be the outcome variable will be a categorical one, like pre-post change in proportion. Okay. So now what is the null hypothesis and what is the alternate hypothesis? So the null hypothesis is the population mean difference between the paired value is equal to zero. Means there is no difference in the pre and post. And alternate will be that there will be difference. That's why it is not equal to zero. Now, straight away coming to the exercise, the demo 2, in the exercise you are seeing that the question is, we have to compare the hemoglobin levels measured in gram per deciliter between hemoglobin baseline and post. And we remember that we gave two interventions. So we have given one intervention like IPC, interpersonal communication to everyone regarding how to improve their diet and why all that counseling regarding the iron folic acid intake. I'm just giving you a hypothetical example. And then I'm comparing like before that IPC, I have used measured the hemoglobin level. And after my IPC, I have used the measure the hemoglobin level. Again, if I take my outcome here as percentage of people who were anemic before and percentage of people who were anemic after my intervention, then what test would we apply?
McNamara.
Yes, McNamara. Because then we are changing it to proportion. But right now, I am taking it as a mean value difference. What was the change in mean hemoglobin before and after? Then we will apply paired t-test. So, we'll see the data. So the data is session 2. Demo. So can you see the demo here? The demo sheet. So I'll explain you a bit. The variable view you can see here. By this time, I think you are now familiar with the name of the variable. It is the ID, gender, race, socioeconomic status, which is a categorical variable, the CVD. Again, categorical intervention. Then again, hemoglobin baseline and post. and then SGOT baseline and post. And you can see here that all this label is missing. Can you see? And this values, these are also missing. So ideally I should put the, because I have imported this from Excel. So whenever you import this from Excel, you should put the label here, the name of the variable and the values too, right? So since it is a mean change, maybe that categories. So here I should have written CVD, although CVD analysis is not here. So zero is absent or no, depending on what you write, CVD absent, and one is CVD present. Okay, although we don't need it here, similarly SES also you will. So that's I'm showing you here right now, because whenever you import the Excel into the SPSS, excuse me, these value will be missing. So these are the, and if you see the data value, so these are the data value. So what was our first assumption? That the dependent variable should be a continuous one. So dependent variable here you have seen in the alternate hypothesis, that alternate hypothesis, what we have found, that the difference of these pre-post should be zero. That is a null hypothesis. An alternate hypothesis that they are not equal to zero. So for paired value, we need to create another variable that is the difference, because in the normality testing, we will test this difference, the normality testing. So now we will see. So what I'll do, I'll create another variable that we do in paired t-test. So you go to transform, you go to compute, and I have to take a variable of this pre-post value. So what I'll do, I'll do hemoglobin post minus hemoglobin baseline, okay? And then press okay. So you will see here that another variable has appeared. Can you see here? This variable was not there beforehand. This hemoglobin difference, okay? This I have created by the option of transform and compute. So you have to go to transform, compute, check this, write hemoglobin difference, a new variable. And we need this another variable, which is the change of value from post to pre, and then press OK. So that will give you this value of hemoglobin difference. Okay. Is it okay up till this point? All of you, or should I repeat anything which you want me to do right now? Okay, if there are no questions.
Yes,
why we have done this? Because in the assumption section, if I go back to my assumption, the assumption says that there, let me see. This is a null, no, this is here also assumption, if you'll see, and it should be normally distributed. There should be no significant outlier in the differences between the two related groups.
Between the two related. Okay.
See, the underlying assumption, if you read it correctly, it says that you have to check the normality of these differences. Again, if you come to null hypothesis, it also says that there is no difference between the paired value, and the alternate says that there is a difference between the pair value. Okay, so that's why to just keep that assumption, we have to do the testing of normality of this difference, not the way we did it for individual, that independent sample t-test. So is it clear to everyone?
Ma'am, when you imported the Excel sheet into the SPSS, the label column was empty. Yes. It was missing. So will it make any difference if you don't put anything in the label column?
Actually, here we are doing the analysis of continuous data. So ideally, it should be there, the label, the way we have taught you. But since, I mean, I could not write it because I imported it from Excel. In the analysis, that table will show SGOT and SGPT and CVT, that short form of variable which you have created. It will not give you the long form. Like it will come like HB underscore diff, because that's the variable. Otherwise, if I label it like, I'll show you. Just see, I have not labeled it.
That will be okay, no? That will be okay because we know it.
Yes, yes. You know.
Okay.
In manuscript, in table, you can write it. But okay, if you don't want to label it, the labeling is only needed when, you know, two people are working or you have given this sheet to somebody else to do some advanced analysis. Maybe person who is not from medical background, because there are many a statistician who don't understand, you know, all these short forms or difference. So maybe for them it is easy if everybody is there on the same page. But if you yourself are doing the analysis, then even if you not have pasted this, labeled it, it is okay. Like if you write CRP, it will be difficult for them. What is CRP? There are many short forms which are similar looking also, like, right? So that's why it is important to give. But if you are many variables and if you are in hurry and if you remember all the name of the variable very well, then you can skip this label also. Okay?
Okay.
So now you can see this difference. Now you have to check for the normal distribution. So what option should I click? Now who will tell me? Dr. Divendu? I have to check the normalcy of this difference. Normalcy, what command should I put for this? If I check, want to check it's there, whether it is normally distributed or not, or for any outlier, what option should I click?
Analyze.
Yes.
And descriptive data, then explore.
Yes, very good. And in explore. Yahan pe I'll only put the hemoglobin difference because there is no factor.
Hemoglobin difference.
Only the pre-post. Yes. Then what I have to do?
Factor. Huh.
Then factor. So there's plot.
No factor. Yes.
Factorless. No factor.
Factor any plots?
Yes, plots. Then.
Plots. Me kya kya kya?
Uncheck.
Plots me ye stem and leaf hata diye.
Check stem and leaf.
वैल्यू ऑफ दिस शापिरो विल्क इट इज मोर देन 105 ऑल्दो फॉर अ सैंपल साइज लेस देन 50 वी यूजुअली डोंट कमेंट ऑन शापिरो विल्क बट स्टिल जस्ट टू memorize that name. I have told you this is that. So you can see, is it a normally distributed QQ plot?
It is normally distributed.
Yes, and it is. You can see that it is the QQ plot of hemoglobin difference, right? And then what comes the box plot. So can you see the box plot?
There are two outliers. Three outliers. 136, 169, and 114.
Yes. So there are only three outliers. So it is up to you. There are three options which you can proceed. Either you can keep the outlier, you can report it that there were three outliers, but I haven't kept that in the analysis, or you can replace the values, or you can remove it. So up to you, right? But I have chosen to keep it in my analysis. And what I'll write? I'll write that the hemoglobin difference was normally distributed by the visual inspection of the QQ plot, and the visual inspection of the box plot showed that there were three outliers, but they were included in the analysis. Okay. Now I have checked this. What should I do now? Again, compare means. Now what should I click here? We have used, when do we use this option of only means? Anyone?
to calculate
the median. For the median.
Yes, median across the two different groups which we have seen.
Yes.
Okay. And then we have seen this independent sample t-test. And now we will see the paired sample t-test. So if you see this now, this interface is very much similar to MacNeMer. There also it was variable 1, variable 2. And in the bottom, there was various options of MacNeMer and other tests. Right. So it is the hemoglobin baseline, hemoglobin post. Right. So variable 1 and variable 2 I have written. You can interchange this. Like if I expect my hemoglobin level to increase after intervention. So if I have put this command baseline minus post, then it will have a negative sign. Sorry, it will have a positive sign here. No. Baseline hemoglobin is less. So I expect that it should be more. So pair 1 and pair 2, it takes out the difference. So if you see the difference, it will show you whether it has taken 1 minus 2 or 2 minus 1. But it doesn't make a difference because by seeing the sign, you can make out your outcome. Whether it is, if it is increased, then it will be on positive. It is, if it is decreased, then it will be a negative one. Okay, then come to the options. In the options, you don't have to do anything. Just click this OK. So can you see this? You can see here that mean value of baseline hemoglobin was 8.5 with a standard deviation of 1.5. Post-intervention, the mean hemoglobin value increased 9.2 and standard deviation was 1.4. If you see here the mean value, there was a difference, means the 0.69, there was change in mean hemoglobin level, there was an increase in mean hemoglobin level. That means it has done 1 minus 2, which while we were entering. Minus means that we have just did 1 minus 2, right? So you could have changed there. Like if I, even if I leave it like this, it is okay. Because while interpreting, you can write it. But if you want that, no, you want a positive value only, then you can come here. In pair t-test, you can so if you use this command, it will change.
मैम दो और बॉक्स नीचे खाली हैं, उसमें क्या डालना, उसमें कुछ नहीं डालना है?
नहीं, उसमें बहुत सारे पेयर्ड वैल्यू डाल सकते हो आप, जैसे अभी तो एक का बता रहे हैं ना, जैसे एसजीओटी एक अलग एग्जांपल है एसजीओटी का, वो भी आप डाल दो यहाँ पे,
तो वो हम साथ साथ कर सकते हैं।
हाँ, बहुत सारे, वैसे इट्स देयर लाइक कोरिलेशन एवरीवेयर, देयर आर मेनी वेरिएबल, यू कैन कीप ऑन एडिंग एंड यू विल गेट द आउटपुट यू नो इन अ सिंगल टेबल, सो दैट इट विल बी इजी फॉर यू टू सी एट वंस।
मैम हाउ टू ऐड अ थर्ड रो?
I'll show you. एक मिनट रुको, ये कर दिया, मान लो ये कर, ये automatically आ जाएगा,
automatically आ जाएगा.
Once you enter second, then it will come. Like again, I have entered hemoglobin. The fourth will appear. So it will keep on appearing.
Okay.
So now let me remove all this, otherwise. And similarly, if you remove this, it will go back also. This will disappear. So what I have done, I have deducted post minus pre, right? But even if you have entered here the baseline and post, so the negative sign will show you that, you know, you was expecting an increase. Is it okay for all of you? Did you understand this or should I repeat this once again?
Understood, ma'am.
Understood.
Okay, yeah. So if you press this now, you can see it has come in a positive value. Whatever we were seeing as a negative one, because it is again the same 1 minus 2 or 2 minus 1. Like SGOT, you will see in the other example that after intervention, you expect SGOT to go down. So in that case, if you in 1 minus 2 is okay, because it will come in a positive thing. So while interpretation, you have to be cautious, like whether it will decrease or increase. So you can see here, it is significant. So that degree of freedom is important here, 192, value of T and significance. This 95% confidence interval you should report, and this is the mean. Mean change, mean increase in the hemoglobin. So what is 0.69? 0.69 is a mean increase in the hemoglobin value after your IPC, interpersonal communication and counseling.
Ma'am, इसमें एक चीज पूछना था कि इसमें 95% confidence interval, it is falling under one only. अच्छा, okay, so it is significant. Yeah, okay, fine, yeah.
Okay. Now you got it, I think. Initially, I think there was some. So if I see how to mean, yes, so this was the. So this is the same command which I have shown you. There will be variable. This is a normality testing. So I have written the difference hemoglobin level were normally distributed as assessed by the Shapiro-Wilk and the QQ inspection. Three outliers were deducted, but they were kept in the analysis. This is the same interface. So this is the one. You can see this is a pre 8.57, post is 9.26. T value is 5.49. Here we have entered the SD value also. So we found in our study that there is a significant increment in the mean hemoglobin level after intervention. The difference in mean hemoglobin was 0.69. 95% confidence interval this. Since P value you have given here, you can write here also. But 90, if you have given the confidence interval, it automatically conveys the P value. So even if you have not said it actively, but confidence interval one should always give. So this was the pair T test. So is it okay for all of you, or should I repeat it once more, the command?
Yeah, I'll
yes?
We don't need a replicates here.
We don't need?
Replicates.
Replicates of what?
Repeated measurements or something.
Repeated, it is also known as a repeated measure. That's why one of the test name, you can call it as a repeated measure t-test also. But repeated measure, we will do in ANOVA. Generally, that term is used when there is a more than two group or more than two time, like CRP. You are taking the COVID patient, the value of CRP or interleukin 6 at 1 day, 5 day, 11 day, 16 day. Then those four values are the same continuous variable which you are measuring at different point of time after treatment, or you know, treatment is going on, then you can use the repeated measure there. But here for that two
R ANOVA,
repeated measure ANOVA, yes. So there we use MOTAM, but again this is also a paired value, so many people call it as a repeated T test also. But generally, it's a paired value, so it's preferable to call it as a paired t-test.
I'm talking about technical replicates, ma'am. Measuring the same value by keeping conditions.
Can you elaborate on your question? Can you, because I think I'm not understanding what you want to take. Can you type in the chat box?
Yeah.
Okay, so I'll answer till the time he's texting. I mean typing. So we'll go ahead with this non-parametric analog of paired t-test, that is the Wilcoxon signed rank test. So Wilcoxon signed rank test, it is a test which is the non-parametric analog of the paired t-test. Assumptions are same. What we'll do, again, we have to create another variable. So whatever, between whatever variable you want to put the t-test, what I'll do, I'll go to compute variable. I'll create another variable, that is the difference of SGOT level. And here, what I'll do, I'll get this baseline minus post, then okay. So you can see another variable of SGOT difference here? So you can see this, a new variable, and again you go to analyze, descriptive, and then go to explore. In explore, instead of this, you shift this variable. All that options are clicked. So continue, and then you can see the, so you can see this is not normally distributed clearly, and you can see the box plot also. So you can see there are many variables which are extreme outlier and the normal outlier. So in that case, we have to use the non-parametric analog of the pair t-test. So go to analyze, non-parametric, legacy dialog, and we have to, it's a two related sample. So press on two related sample. So I have told you this is a Wilcoxon signed rank test. So it is automatically clicked. The same option we use for McNemar if it is a proportion, and then we click, we used to click the McNemar. So here the SGOT pre, SGOT post, and other thing I don't have to see. Okay. So you will see the value of Z. It is significant. And the mean rank. Now again, like we have seen the calculation of median, here also you will calculate the median. So go to analyze, compare means, mean. Now you have to put this SGOT baseline, SGOT post option. Again, shift these three back to this and median, continue. Okay. So you will have a median value. You can see here median value of SGOT was 50, which has decreased to 35. So you can put that in the table. So this is the same thing which I have shown you. Non-parametric. Okay, I don't see this. Sorry, I'll remove this. Mean. Yes. At the time of discharge, we have measured the SGOT levels of patients and give them counseling. So you have measured SGOT after 3 months. So this was a mean intervention. Then I have to remove this IQR, because this IQR you don't have to report. Z value, P value, and the SGOT was not normally distributed. That's why Wilcoxon signed rank test was used. The median post-intervention was SGOT, which was lowered as compared to pre-intervention. You can give the value here, 15, but that it is showing a difference. Either you can...
I have one question, ma'am. Should we write SGOT level, or difference in SGOT level was not normally distributed?
You should write difference. Difference. It's wrongly framed here, because in assumption also we are checking the difference. So it's a wrongly written statement. You should write that the difference in SGOT level was not normally distributed. This is just because, I mean, we are not writing this, analysis part. So somebody else is missing it. Okay. So the difference, thank you for pointing out, we'll correct it. And that shows you are very, focused. So thank you, Viraval. So I think, is it clear, or should I repeat it once again? So in the write-up, you can write here. No, that's it. This, you don't have to write. This is a, okay. I mean, for you, this much is okay. So again, the same thing. You have to, again, I'll tell the commands once again. So again, we will create this different variable by the transform compute option, where we this numeric expression, we'll click and press OK. And then what we do, we have to go to analyze and remember non-parametric legacy dialog. Go to non-parametric legacy dialog. In legacy dialog, two related sample because it is related, and pre and post value, and then click on will, it is automatically click this Wilcoxon, then OK, and then this will come. And then again, for mean median calculation, you have to go compare means. And in means, you the dependent, you will put this two options, press, then move this median to this cell statistics, and then continue, and then this that median will appear. So if you got this, then we'll move to the breakout room. So Haripriya, you please open the breakout room so that they can practice on their exercise sheet. We'll start with the one-way ANOVA. So we'll see. So we did today the difference in mean of the two group. Then we did the paired difference of mean of a paired value, which we see, we saw a lot of research questions where there can be a paired value of the same outcome variable, or the same outcome variable will be measured under two different intervention. So both will be a paired t-test. Now, if there are more than two groups, then we do this one-way ANOVA. It has got, we will discuss two things, two type of one-way ANOVA. One-way ANOVA, and there is a repeated measure ANOVA. So one-way ANOVA is the same as independent sample t-test, except that it has got more than two groups. Similarly, repeated measure ANOVA is same as paired t-test, except it has got more than two values, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. That's why it is known as the repeated measure ANOVA. So one-way ANOVA, it is also known ANOVA, the full form is the analysis of variance. So it is a variance between subject. It is also known as the between subjects ANOVA, one factor ANOVA, where we compare the means of more than two groups. And the most important part is the post hoc analysis. Like a type of post hoc analysis, where you have seen this post hoc, I have used this term post hoc analysis.
In chi-square.
Yes, in chi-square, where there were more than
adjusted
3 by 2 or 3 by 3 or 3 by 4, then we have seen this post hoc analysis by seeing the value of adjusted residual. Here, we will also see this post hoc analysis between which pair, because there will be many combinations that we will see in the analysis. So, post hoc analysis is an important part of this one-way ANOVA. Now, see this example. You can see there's a male and female where there are 5 BMI of this male. The frequency is 5 and the mean is 18.2. Similarly, the female also has got the 5 value of MI and the frequency, this mean is 26.4. So if I have to test the difference between these two mean across male and female, what test should I use? Anyone? Please unmute and answer. You have to be with me till next 10 minutes because I'll be asking questions. So don't just, be less attentive.
T-test, independent T-test.
Independent T-test, yes. Now see this. There are three groups, male, female, and transgender. The BMI of these three group, the mean is 18.2, 26.4, and 23.6. Now who will answer? Let me ask. So who will answer this? Dr. Divendu? Okay. Viraval. So you always say, okay, that's good. It is ANOVA. So when we have to test the mean of more than two sampling population, then we use ANOVA. So this is just a diagram to show you the difference between what is the within group variance and what is the between group variance. So if like there are three population, you have seen like there is a distribution of this is the male, this is female, and this is transgender. So if we study the variance between male and transgender, this is known as the between group variance. And if we see the variance within one group, then this is known as the within group variance. Similarly, you can see this, this is the within group variance and this is the between group variance. So there are three basically basic assumptions are the dependent variable should be continuous, like we did in the independent sample t-test. Again, the independent variable should have more than two categories. So similar concept we did in the independent sample t-test, where we learned that it should be a dichotomous only. There should be only two variables. But here, what can we say? That there should be more than two variables. There should be independence of observation. And this independence of observation means that the one set of individual cannot be the same individual for the other intervention or other group. So that is the independence of observation. The dependent variable should be normally distributed in the categories of the independent variable, like we saw in the independent sample t-test. There should be no significant outlier in the dependent variable, that also we know. And the homogeneity of variance, that should be equal in the all categories of the independent variable. So all the assumptions are exactly similar to what we did in the independent sample t-test. The difference is just that we are doing it for more than two independent category.
Ma'am, if you go to previous slide, the second point, is it dependent
this
variable?
One. No. Here you want to understand something?
Next slide. At this point.
No significant outlier.
Yeah, is it independent variable or dependent?
So there should be no significant outlier in the dependent variable across independent variable. Because like we did in the independent sample t-test, that we studied the SBP value in male and female. So similarly, here we will do the continuous variable across the independent variable. So outlier will be in the dependent variable, but again, that will be the across all categories of independent variable. Okay.
Okay.
Okay. So this is the question. So I'll, this is again the same question, very much similar. I have to see the SBP value with respect to BMI categories, whether they are under following normality under different categories or not. And we have to test whether variance within the BMI categories are equal or not. So for normalcy, what we will do, I'll show you the commands. We'll go to analyze and descriptive and then explore. In the descriptive here, we'll do here? The same. The dependent we'll move to the SBP and the factor we'll put the BMI category. Here we will check the plots. And in the option, what I have to do, I have to uncheck this stem and leaf and I have to check this normality plot with test. And this is the value of Shapiro-Wilk, which you can see all the three values are more than 0.5. Although the sample size is more than 50, that's why we'll see the QPP plot. This QQ plot, you can see both the plots are the normally distributed. Then again, this is the across the category three. So BMI category one and two and three, it is normally distributed. And if you see the box plot, you can see that there are only two outliers in the category two. Otherwise, there is no outlier. So this is a very few outliers, so I can go ahead with the repeated measure, ANOVA. Now, I have to test for the homogeneity of variance. So homogeneity of variances, we have talked, like there should be equal variance in the all the three group. And generally, it is equal if the group sizes are equal. Group sizes means you will see that the number of individuals in BMI CAT 1, BMI CAT 2, and BMI CAT 3, they should be nearly equal. If there is a huge imbalance between the group sizes,
ma'am, you are audible.
Oh, I'm audible. Okay, because of some internet connection, I think I got unheard for a few minutes. So I'll again repeat. I think I was explaining the test of homogeneity of variance. So this is same as we did in the independent sample t-test. So the homogeneity of variances should be homogeneous means same, and variance is the variability which we have done. So variances of all the three groups should be similar across the group. So we use Levine test, and we know that it should not be significant. The p-value should be less than point, should be more than 0.05. So if homogeneity of variance is not equal, then we use the value of Welsh ANOVA that we'll see. And we use a different post hoc test as we do it for the not the normal ANOVA. So again, this is the same command, compare means and one-way ANOVA. And in the one-way ANOVA, you have to, in the dependent one, you have to move the SBP and the factor, that will be BMI cat. So I'll show you the commands on the, maybe the original sheet. Or we can continue this next time. I'll just show you the commands once on the one-way ANOVA. So I've canceled this. So what I have to do, this is the one-way ANOVA. I have to first do the explore normalcy. So this is the SBP and BMI cat. Right? Again, the same options which I have shown you. Click on the plot. This is normality. And then OK. So if you see the output, all that test and plots that we have seen right now, that will appear along with the box plot. This was the one which we saw. Then you go to analyze, then compare means one-way ANOVA. So this was the SBP and this was the BMI cat. And then in the post hoc, this contrast you don't have to, yes, in the post hoc, you have to click on two keys, right? So click on two keys and then press this. You have seen this equal variance is not assumed. So there, right now, I have no idea about the Levine's test because the value comes only after I put the command. So I'll take this also, Gaims-Howell, because when the equal variance is not assumed, then we have to take the value of Gaims-Howell. We have to see this post hoc. This we were not doing in the independent sample t-test as there was no post hoc comparison. So, but there also you must have seen that there were two outputs, equal variances assumed and equal variances not assumed. So here we it don't take automatically. For post hoc, we have to click on the Gaims-Howell. So two names you have to remember. If the equal variances assumed, you have to click this two keys. If not assumed this, then Gaims-Howell, then continue. And in options, you can see, so all you have to check on these three options, descriptive, homogeneity of variance test, because this you have to click, that is a Levine's test, and this Welsh ANOVA, because if group sizes are not equal, then I have to take the value of this Welsh. This mean plot we don't report, but you may click it just to see the variation of the mean value in the three different groups. Then continue, okay. And then you can see here, the descriptive, it will show you the mean and standard deviation of all the SBP 137. It will show you the 95% confidence interval. You can see the value of Levine statistics. It is the 0.343. That means the equal variances are assumed. That means you have to take the, now you can see the value of ANOVA. So the difference of SBP in the three groups are significant. Now the important is the post hoc. So you can see this post hoc, and we will see this interpretation of post hoc in the next class. because I think you, I mean, it will take some time for me to explain, right? So I think we can end the class now, and we will, there will be exercises for you. This PowerPoint will be shared to you, ANOVA, and maybe not ANOVA because we have not completed, but that paired t-test and the independent sample t-test by today itself, and you will get the exercise and demo sheet of SPSS so that you can practice at home, and you may submit your assignment. Okay, so all that is instructions will be posted in the Google Classroom as well as in the group. If any query I can address now, you are most welcome. Okay.